So, ladies and gentlemen, our next panel discussion is going to be on the changing landscape, but of marketing. Are we ready to take the big leap of marketing in the realm of complex consumers, multi-platforms, and multi-screen world? How to make it effective? Well, the session chair for this panel discussion is going to be Mr. Vikas Mehta. He's the CEO of 0.9 Lintas. Vikas has worked with the global Mullen Law Group since 2006 in various leadership roles. At the age of 31, he was named Managing Director of Law of Vietnam, making him the youngest country head in the global network. In 2011, he was named Regional Growth Officer for Law of Asia Pacific, where he managed businesses, agencies working across 15 countries. Vikas, I request you to please come and join me on stage, and he's going to be your moderator for this session. The food was good. I'm sure it would have given you some energy. A big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Now I'm going to invite our panelists for the session. I would request Ms. Anika Agarwal, Senior VP and Head Marketing, Digital and Direct Sales, Max Bupa, Health Insurance, to please join me on stage, along with Dinesh Arora, Digital Head, Angel Broking, Prashant Verma, VP Marketing, Grofers, and Ms. Trupti, Bhandari, Global Lead, Base Horlicks and Boost, GSK Consumer Healthcare. Ladies and gentlemen, this is your panel, and I am now going to hand it over to Vikas.
Can you folks hear me? Good afternoon, we'll try and keep you awake. So, thank you so much for calling us here. I think it's lovely to have the session right after lunch. It's the most exciting time of the day. So we're talking about how the marketing organization needs to evolve to respond to what I like to call, and most of you like to call, the VUCA world. But I think the emphasis we'd like to keep on today is how the whole equation of, because effectiveness is a subject we all talk about, and I think it's probably one of the most bandied around terms in our business, that was it effective or not. So what we'd like to do today is spend the next 30 minutes A, trying not to bore you, and B, trying to talk about the aspect of return on investment which makes up the subject matter of effectiveness. So I think to kick things off, let me just set the context from one or two observations which have come as an outcome of the environment in which we live today. So digital touch points pretty much were born, let's say, 23 years ago when Google became a part of our lives. And the promise to a marketeer was that digital is going to remove all the intermediaries between brands and their customers. While that promise has come true to a large extent, an exactly reverse thing has also happened, that today, between platforms, aggregators, display networks, search networks, trading desks, and to deal with it, the horizontal as well as the vertical screens in our lives, there are actually thousands and thousands of layers between brands and their customers that are also equally come about. So how do you measure return on investment in such a disparate environment is something that I think we should spend the next 20 minutes thinking about. And we have a very, very interesting mix of industries here with us. So let's set the ball rolling by asking each of the panelists, and I promise this is the only question I would ask all of them to answer, is in their industry, since the marketing mixes have become a lot more complex, if you could each just talk about the primary component of your marketing mix today, and on that specific element, how has the subject of you measuring return on investment evolved over the last few years? Could we start with you, Anika?
So hello, just to give you a quick context, I work in the health insurance industry. Two words there, health and insurance. Insurance, a very, very traditional industry where, you know, the distributor is actually the consumer, and it is that distributor who actually goes and talks to your customer about the product. That has changed significantly for us. And health, a general topic of interest, I think, today for all Indians. But today, a health insurance company which finances your health, or bad health if that happens, I think that's the customer that we are dealing with. You look at the category which is slightly under-penetrated and was a distribution heavy category. In such a case, you know, there's been a tremendous evolution for us as a category first before a brand. And you know, the lines are blurring. So yes, we have an omni-channel experience. We have a lot of data about our customers today. But if we talk about marketing effectiveness and attribution today, the approach that we've evolved over the years is that we've got a lot of data on our customers, which is a good thing about the category. But, you know, where do you attribute it to? Is it the last click or is it digital, you know, where you're spending crores and crores of money today, but finally the distributor says that, you know, I went and sold your product. There are only 2 or 3% of customers who go and buy end-to-end online. So I think the approach that we are taking on attribution, and we'll talk about it later, is that you have to be where the customer is. It's not so much about, you know, whether it's TV or whether it's print or whether it's digital. I think it is more about, you know, are you present where the customer is? And that's the line of attribution to follow versus, you know, just media channels. So that's, it's a more channel-agnostic approach.
I think that's very interesting, because now if we superimpose, Dinesh, your industry on it, which is your offering is largely driven into stocks, and I'm assuming a large chunk of your business comes online. Would you want to talk about how's the measurement environment in your industry like?
Okay, just to give you a little idea about my industry, so it's broken. We all talk about this industry and we said, okay, this is the industry where we can make money easily. That's what the term that people say a lot of time. And now, you know, I heard a lot of the people say that, okay, we would like to open a broking account that can help us because stocks is easy money. But I see adaption of this industry is not that easy till now. I think I've seen very few people actually go ahead and actually open the account. But the main thing, opening account is maybe easy, but the issue is that investing and continue investing in this industry. Whereas see that we are still in a very niche, and we are still, you know, there's too far that we have to go to that people get, you know, very aware about the industry and actually they can think that how they can actually invest and how they can use this particular medium to double their money. Now, adding that part, the major thing that we see as a marketing objective we see is acquisition is maybe one objective we can see, but the major is that how we actually keep the retention going on. That was the major thing that I have. And when I see my marketing mix and the channel, I said, how can I actually try to get more customers who would keep on investing and continue investing in the space?
Right. Prashant, your business is, I guess, as minute by minute measurable as it gets. Is it easier or harder when it comes to measuring and attributing the impact of what worked and what didn't?
Ah, wow, that's a good question. So, yeah, our business as such as, you know, Grofers is online grocery. It's different from other e-commerce in the sense that rest of e-commerce is a want-based business. This is a need-based business. And hence, the frequency of purchase and everything and the ticket size of purchase is very different from the rest of e-com. Measurement for us is... what we observe here is the marketing funnel is no longer linear at Grofers. What you think you're doing for consideration may just drive intent to purchase, right? That's something, it's actually a very cross matrix for us. So measurement for us as, and I would carry on from where Dinesh left off, it's essentially it starts off with acquisition. And in our case, retention takes precedence over it because it's the lifetime value of the consumer who you're bringing onto the table. And you eventually end up optimizing for that, right? So when I go back to your question about being harder or easier, it actually becomes harder because we can measure everything to the T. Like, we know who's buying the preferred brand of toothpaste, what have been the purchase patterns. We can actually classify who's purchased, let's say, we've actually ended up creating more like 100 consumer profiles, and our consumer journeys on the platform and off the platform, essentially how we target them, vary as per these particular journeys.
So from a business that measures practically everything to a business that sells products that we've known since we were kids, Trupti, how is it different for your scenario?
Hello. So good afternoon, everyone. We look after health food drinks, which is the brand's Horlicks Boost mentioned here. So very, very traditional brands, been around for more than 100 years. So our form of marketing is also quite traditional in that sense. And media forms the most important chunk of our marketing to reach our consumers. What I would say is over the last few years, however, the proportion of media has gone down and we've started experimenting with a lot of digital, a lot of content, PR, and some of the other avenues to reach consumers. Now, we would still be 80% media, and if it comes to measurement, I think because media has been around for so long, there are techniques and tools which are available to measure the ROI. Having said that, because the other methods, which is the digital marketing and stuff, that's where we are really struggling still. And while we would love to say that we understand the ROI that these vehicles give, I think that's the place where intuition plays the biggest role. So sometimes you try to lay a lot of stress on quantity, and that's where you know that, okay, you've got 80% reach at 2x frequency. But the moment you come to these newer age marketing vehicles, that's the time when you need to stress a little more on quality, and though you know that the numbers may not be high, you judge basis your intuition that I'm reaching the right TG and therefore the convergence will be the highest. So that's where we are right now and hope to evolve the ROI method better, but well, we are struggling, I would say.
You make a very interesting point about how the ROI methods are evolving, and I think in a business where, and let's look at some of the platform businesses where there are dashboards available to pretty much measure every aspect of your marketing dollar and where it's going. Now here's a point where I would want, Dinesh, your perspective. Let's talk about brand equity. I'm assuming in the online broking business, a lot of energy goes behind customer acquisition. And repeat transactions is sometimes a reflection of loyalty, but at times it can just be a reflection of a habit. So at your organization, how do you isolate transactional success versus building loyalty? And what are the things you do to think about the aspect of brand equity and measuring it?
To answer that point, acquisition is one way, but retention is not easy for us. And how we ensure that the acquisition and retention work separately, I generally manage a two team where, you know, the one team is exactly only focusing how to retain the customer, give them the right experience, and ensure that we are listening them what they are looking for and how we can actually address these things. Now, loyalty in our industry is also it's also a confused word that we say, because loyalty depends upon the kind of offers and the rates that you provide. That is the case right now. And with the competition where you have a full service broker and the only, you know, just the managed services kind of a thing, in that case, you know, where you find the lower brokerage people move. So you actually kind of keep on segmenting your user and figure out which one are the profitable customers and the customers who are very active in platform, and how you actually learn from them and kind of give them same advice to the other user, and how can you make, you know, elevate them to more premium customer for you. And that's what the team will keep on working so that we can actually, you know, keep them happy with us.
So let me take an example, let's say from, because let's move from one underpenetrated sector to another, which is health insurance. Anika, in your experience, which are the initiatives that probably are geared towards building preference versus initiatives that are built towards building a transaction?
Sure.
How do you put your finger on where to spend which part of your marketing dollars on?
So that's an interesting question, and I go back to the the summit theme today, which is starting with complex customers. I don't think customers are complex. The challenge today is that, you know, earlier as marketers, we used to think information is at a premium. So, you know, I am giving the information and I am controlling the narrative. Today, the narrative is not controlled by us, and I think that's the biggest sort of discomfort that all of us as human beings and marketers have, that someone else is, controlling the narrative. So I think when we talk about word of mouth, it's all interlinked. We talk about, you know, the detractors that we have currently, and that's the worst sort of, conversation that they can have about me as a brand today. So when we talk about, you know, marketing investments, I think we are placing a premium on customer experience. So if we spend an X amount of money on acquisition, and it's a high growth category, I mean, we grow upwards of 30 to 40%, which is not to be said for many categories today. It's a sunrise industry. I would still spend half of my money on building customer experience today, because that is where my brand narrative is also controlled. So to take a case in point in terms of investments in technology, infrastructure, or marketing, if I were to invest in acquiring new users today, I create lookalikes of my existing customers. So we have a lot of data, we have health data, we have demographic data. So, you know, if you have that kind of data for your customers, you can create lookalikes and, you know, target the most profitable customers in terms of acquisition. But that's one part of the story. The other large investment, and if I talk about my personal time structure investment, at least 40 to 50% of it today is going in controlling the customer experience for us. So whether it is a digital customer experience or even experience, let's say, at hospitals where, you know, finally the promise is fulfilled, a large part of the team energy also goes in there. So the question again then comes back to, you know, structure, skill sets within the marketing team, if that's the kind of focus that we are building. But customer experience for a category like ours, even though underpenetrated, is key.
So look, that's actually, I think that brings me to another point, that if we go around this table, I think we have three organizations which the nature of your business is very data rich. And in a manner of speaking, the real-time pulse of consumer behavior is available to you almost at a dashboard level. But let's look at a large business where, Trupti, you don't have the luxury of so much real-time information. In case of, but we all know that it's a brand that we grew up with, and probably building affinity is as or more important than building trials. How do you define your mix to, especially the efforts that are built towards building affinity or emotional equity? Have the measures for those aspects changed in the past few years?
If you look at RTG, the TG is really the mom, you know, and the product that we give her is something that she uses to be able to grow her child most comprehensively. So the involvement is extremely, extremely high. And given that, she is, in today's environment, she's also very informed, because earlier she was believing the products which were handed down to her by her mom, by her grandmom. But today, because she is so informed, she is, while on one hand she knows that there's a legacy product, she is also seeking information constantly. So therefore, it is very, very important to be on her right side. And the tricky part is, it's a combination of both rational as well as emotionally trying to appeal to her. So to that extent, it's not just about the product benefit, but what is the emotional payoff that she gets. And when you come to that, obviously there is a connect that you need to create with her. So while a lot of our effort goes in getting in new users, you know, because as new age, trying to be contemporary and relevant to the new mom, lot of effort actually also goes in still staying relevant to the existing users, connecting with them so that they become advocates for the newer moms and, you know, passing it on to their family and friends, especially in today's time when there is so much of influence that works. This mom is no different. So I would say a lot of our effort actually goes in creating the right language for the brand so that the mom is completely convinced and proud of being associated with us.
So let me bring that now to another perspective, which is measurement and ROI come naturally to all things digital. Prashant, in your experience, are there any learnings from the digital measurement models which might actually be useful in modeling of ROI for some of the more legacy and traditional media?
So what we've done at Grofers is actually measure TV ROI, right? That may sound complex and that may sound different, but when we start our TV planning, we start on the classical principles of reach, frequency, duplication, etc. But when we measure our TV, it's on the basis of actually spot analysis. I mean, we've actually set up an in-house data team and set up an in-house modeling team for that. So what we've done is let's say a spot plays at 8:30 p.m. On Star Sports, right? What is the ROI of that particular ad which is played at that point of time? We actually end up measuring it on the basis of the hits that we get on the website. That's the incremental visits, the incremental installs which we give on the app, the downloads which we get overall on both iOS and Android. So that's something which we've tried to develop on our own. And that's the kind of measurement which we do like at Grofers. Like, because as I said earlier, the consumer funnel has become a lot more complex. People bounce around, right? So while you may think that television was for awareness, it ends up becoming for intent and purchase too. Right. And that's the kind of modeling which we end up doing, and our TV planning as such is actually changed week on week. Right. We end up creating a plan based on reach and frequency, but then post that we end up modifying our plan week on week as per the results of each week.
That's very interesting. And have you had any experiences of legacy businesses probably borrowing those learnings from Grofers or vice versa?
So I think once e-commerce penetration grows to a higher level, that's when legacy businesses can actually end up seeing the impact of their advertising which goes on television, because that's when a bulk of the sale which happens on the e-com platform will actually see up.
Right. So here's what I'm hearing, and there's a part of it that's bothering me a little. Our view of effectiveness seems extremely myopic around this room right now. And I say that with all due respect to the environment that we live in, where I guess the quarter is the new long term. And of course, there are pressures as well as priorities for delivering instant results and measurable results. But I think one of the fundamental things of the whole subject of marketing effectiveness is also about the long-term impact on people's mindsets that you make as initiatives. So, Shavi, let's spend the next few minutes talking about work that your organizations may be doing in terms of measuring the long-term impact. Like, and I think companies like GSK, for example, where you own brands that have been around for a very, very long time, there is, of course, the equity measures that have been in place, and there's a lot of pre and post evaluation that has been done for a very long time. What I would want to hear is from some of the under-penetrated categories, let's take health insurance, for example. How do you measure the long-term impact of initiatives which are beyond instant results?
So I think two things, and taking his point forward, when we talk about digital measurement and this era of digital measurement, the pressures are always there of saying, you know, why should you do this? This doesn't see any short-term movement. So what we've actually started to do are build out models which take, you know, one digital metric as a core, which is, let's say, search volume. So today there's a search volume growth that I have, there's a category search growth volume, and there's a brand search growth volume. So anything that you're doing today, what is the impact on the brand search volume? Because that's where you're really building, you know, going down to the funnel and building preference. So on everything that we do, even for a, you know, for a lead or an ROI, for example, we measure that now, and we're in very initial stages right now because the data collection itself is such a huge ask. But you know, in categories like ours where people don't want to have a conversation with us, right? So, you know, taking GSK example, as a mom, I would want to have a conversation with Boost. But health insurance is a black swan category. I don't want to talk bad health with you. So I think we always keep aside, you know, few initiatives which are linked to our purpose. So, you know, building the brand with a purpose. Our purpose, for example, is building healthier, more successful lives. The conversation is around how to keep the customers healthy. So about, you know, 15 to 20% of the marketing spend today is actually going in having that good health conversation or allowing our customers to stay healthy. So we have initiatives like Walk for Health. We've actually recently launched a product which is, you know, rewarding people to stay out of hospital. So that's a lateral position we've taken as a brand. It doesn't have great takers. It's not as if it's 50% of our product portfolio. But these kind of initiatives actually keep the brand purpose alive and, you know, have a meaningful conversation with the customers.
I think you make a very interesting point that an whole subject of innovation, every time you come up with an innovative product where there isn't really an existing benchmark of where to evaluate success from. Dinesh, in the broking industry, let's say you're in a situation of launching a product initiative or a product format that doesn't exist or doesn't have mass adoption today. How would you go about creating the right benchmark for success?
So if you're saying that I'm launching a new product that is not there in the market, so initially I don't have a benchmark for this actual product. Then what I do is that figure out the product that is near to my product. Like suppose if I am thinking of mutual fund and I don't have any benchmark for it, I'll see what is the adoption rate and the industry benchmarking for broking for that matter. And I try to put some number using that, and then I'll think about my strategy and then I see how can I reach toward those numbers. But initially when I don't have the benchmark, I have to think about the nearest possible category can give me some idea about the benchmarking.
So we have last 2 minutes. I have one quick question for each one of you, 30 seconds or less. Advice for this room, if somebody is at, let's say, ground zero of building their measurement infrastructure in their organization, what's the bare minimum it takes to get started on putting your company on the path of being able to measure and act according to the information and become an effective marketing machinery? 30 seconds.
So I would say three things. Incentivize contactability for the customer. I think that's always the first step. Invest in having at least the right people to analyze data that you collect and tell you in advance. So a data scientist in the team, I think, should be a part of every CMO structure today. And third, I think across the organization, just that data awareness in terms of collection of as much of data as possible, analyzing it in real time, and you know, sensitizing even the top management to it, because a lot of times all of this conversation remains within the marketing teams, and you know, your CEO, for example, is like, you know, what the hell are you talking about today? So I think that's something that you need to keep in mind.
That's a fabulous point, Dinesh.
So if you begin a new organization, I think what matters may that instead of focusing on the end goal, you should also try to see how your channels are working with each other and things, and try to have an integrated marketing in place. Third, I agree with the contactability part, that we should have it here too. And fourth is that ensure that whatever step that you're taking, it should be planned from the across the channel point of view, not specific for one channel person. Like if you're thinking of a theme, it has to be implemented across the channel.
Thanks. Prashant, 30 seconds.
I'll try and do it in 15. So one, set up your data team. Two, define the role of each medium. Three, act on it.
That's really rapid fire. Okay, so I would say three things for me are, first of all, focusing on building long-term equity and not just short-term gains. And towards that, being really authentic to the consumer, because they see through, and if you do that, will you be able to build your equity? And lastly is taking calculated risks, because the more safe you play, you will just keep doing what you were doing all those years.
Fabulous. Let me just, instead of summing this up, let me actually leave you all with a question. And I think the whole subject of measurement is, think of every touch point as pretty much a platform which has its own dashboard. And if you compare that to most probably the car that you probably drove today, what a dashboard can tell you is a lot of information about how your engine is performing, what's the temperature of your car, what's the rev, what's the speed, so on and so forth. But remember that very few dashboards will ever tell you where the car is going. And I think the whole crux of the effectiveness subject is about starting with the clarity of the destination and finding milestones and measures along your way. And another piece of advice which I have learned the hard way over many, many experiences is, I think on the game of measurement and effectiveness, let's all be open to failing, but failing fast. Because eventually, it's a game, the more you play it, the better you get at it. Do we have any questions from the audience? Excellent, you've been a wonderful audience. Thank you, my panelists. Thank you so much.